So inside this box, I'm excited to finally open up the brand new version 2 LifePower4 battery by EG4. I bought this with my own money, but I'm looking forward to adding it into my system. Here we go. First thing, we've got a manual, quality control checks, Cat6 data cable. We've got our beefier terminal connectors. And the easiest thing to do at this point is to cut it out of the box instead of trying to lift it out. All right, so this is the new V2 version of the LifePower4 budget server rack style battery. As many of you guys know, I've got 6 of these sitting right over here. They're right here. And they are awesome. I love them. I had a little bit of balancing issues, but some firmware updates just completely took all that away. We're able to run our entire house most days on just those batteries, what's stored in them. That's fantastic. But here we've got the V2, and let's talk about some of the main differences. If you're here, you've probably seen other channels review these batteries, and you know most of it, but we're going to do a quick rundown. Bigger terminals. This is awesome. It allows you to carry more current. It's just sturdier. You don't feel like you're going to strip them out as easy. Everything about it is better. Plus, you've got 2. So that makes that much better. The next thing is we've got a breaker, which is on the V1, but that's not the only way you turn these batteries on and off. You've got the BMS right here. So you can have the breaker on and the BMS off, and you're not going to be sending any energy out. So that's new, having BMS control. Next, we've got the protocol dip switches here. And that's going to allow you to basically tell the battery what type of inverters and batteries you're dealing with. And I believe I need to put these 2 down over here because I'm going to be syncing this up with my existing 6 batteries. Then next, we've got an LCD output from USB. Type A. That's something I've not dealt with before, so I'd like to maybe get another screen and monitor the battery's performance. I'm hoping that this pack will actually pull data from the other V1s downstream. The next thing is we have both CAN and RS-485, so that opens up more possibilities. One of the things that I'm most excited about is getting the Chargeverter reading this battery pack and then pulling state of charge instead of just pulling voltage for the whole setup. So that's going to be great. I'm really excited about that. And then we can also use the other port to connect to the inverters. Plus, having the CAN allows for better communication from what I understand. That's pretty much it on the front, other than we've got these handles right here, which allow us to get them out of the way, although it is kind of weird that they kind of flex on you when you're moving things around, but hey, that's all right. Outside of that, check out some of the other creators. They talk about the build quality, the teardown. They open up the lid and look inside. It's pretty interesting. There's also fire arresters, and this also has better UL certifications for places that don't like freedom and liberty. If you live in one of those places, you can probably use these batteries now. Yay. So the problem many of us are going to face is we've got this cabinet chock full already. We got 6 batteries in it. That's what it takes. Don't want to buy another cabinet. I just wanted 1 extra battery. If you're in that situation, comment below. So I want to put it on top here. And if you've seen the short I put out a couple days ago, you'll notice that I'm 3D printing up some stuff to put here. And I'm going to actually set the battery on top of all of these wires. Maybe not the best idea, but I've been iterating these feet right here. All right, the only difference between these 2 is this one is heavier than this one. I took out a lot of infill and then I ended up with this one. Next, I decided to get rid of even more. So I got rid of these walls, plus this one is going to go on the front here. And this is a hole that'll actually take a bolt right here. These guys are gonna go on the back. Next, I've got one on the printer, and while it's still printing, we are going to work on something else. We've got to figure out how to communicate with these guys and do so in a way that doesn't trip the alarm. So if you notice, all the lights came on. I'm going to plug this guy in, and it's plugged into the last battery down there. Now it's going to be plugged into the first one, but this is just to show what's going to happen. Plug it in, breaker flipped off, and it tripped the alarm. This is a super cool feature and I'm glad that it's included, but we've got to figure out how to fix the pinout. Luckily, we've already had some other community members figure it out. I actually noticed it on Gavin's channel and you can check that out. And then he mentioned some other guy, which I can't remember, shout out to him. I'll put you in the description. Found out that you can just snip all of the pins that you don't need. I don't have a cable long enough, so we're gonna make our own. All right, so from what we've been told, all we need is the brown and brown stripe. So we're gonna deal with those. All we're looking for is these two. So I'm gonna cut these guys back. I believe brown stripe is gonna go on the inside. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and slide this guy on. Just like this. And they're gonna go all the way on the far right. Just like that. Of course, we wanna get closer up. So I'm gonna cut it about right here. Of course, we want to make sure that we can see it coming through. I'm going to go ahead and crimp it. We'll see what happens. Going to repeat for the other side. Well, we're not going to know if it communicates yet, but we will know if it trips it. So I've got it plugged into that last battery again. Got to turn it on. And we will stick it in there. That should work. I have a feeling that this is not gonna go so well.
Yeah, gosh, this thing's heavy.
Definitely shouldn't be sliding it all over these wires like this. My goal right now is to simply get these feet taped on here. This is another one of those, like, phone a friend. Keep trying to do things by yourself. Yeah, that's pointless. Let's go ahead and get this guy up. So, we've teetered it up on two of them. That went better than it could have. Now I gotta get the one off the 3D printer, and it's got a few minutes left. Fast forward a few days, and this is what we've got. Sorry for not showing you guys the entire build. I got carried away. So I went ahead and made a couple extra cables here. And these are, I don't remember what size they are. Actually took them off of the original Chargeverter because I had the lugs on these sides. And then I put another lug set on the other side. So it's here, I believe. Yeah, coming through. And then I've actually got the Chargeverter on top of it. Now, technically this cabinet is not built out for spec. These bus bars aren't technically capable or aren't I guess, supposed to have this many batteries on it. So use that information as you will. I'll show you this guy right here. For some reason, whenever I redesigned this side, I decided to mess this part up. You see, it's supposed to be flat here so that these can go right down to the bottom. And then I was like, hey, you know what? I'm gonna beef this guy up. And so I made a like a 45 on this side as well, not realizing it. So I ended up cutting that off. But we just got a little guy right here that's holding it from falling off this side. And then there's actually a lip right here that it rests on. So, and then this goes through and just keeps it in place. It would be awesome if there was a way to do something similar back there, but I can't think of anything immediately. If anyone's interested in these files, I will put them in a link below. If they're not there immediately, give me a little bit of time. I'll get them quick. All right, from there. So battery communications. I ended up finding another shorter cable that was factory, and I just snipped. I ended up snipping everything but the brown and brown white, brown and brown stripe, rather. So I do have the other cable and it works fine, but I wanted to test this as well. So that's what we've got. Then we've got the CAN protocol, that one is going to this inverter behind me. And then the RS485 is going to the Chargeverter. So this is awesome. I love this because now I can actually get a voltage reading or a percentage. See, I've got 73 SOC down there in the bottom right. So I've got that, and then I can actually hook up generator start or anything that I need off of that. I like having that a lot. So how is it working? Well, I got overzealous and I installed this when it was 100% and these were not. And so it didn't, and since this is the master battery here, these guys charged it up to 100 and then these only went to about 50 and I had some issues there. So I ended up getting them all. I used the Chargeverter to individually charge each one. And I charged them up to 56 volts, I believe it was. And then from there, it ended up balancing itself out and they've been great. The SOC lights have been the same. Now, it was really weird. It took, I don't know, about 4 days, maybe 3 days for the monitoring software to accurately show that we had the correct amount of batteries. It was really weird. It started off saying it had like 12 batteries and then it ended up saying, so it took a long time on the desktop. The mobile recognized it pretty quick and the desktop still doesn't read the state of charge on these properly. So I've contacted Signature Solar and EG4 both and they're supposed to be looking into it. So you might find that and go, this is really weird. And under here, I've got plenty of room for the wires. Nothing's getting bound up. Nothing's getting like overheated because of lack of airflow or anything like that. I think this is a really cool stand. If you guys are interested, like I said, just go ahead and check out the files in the description. You'll have to 3D print them yourself. By far, the most difficult thing is figuring out the dip switches. And I don't know why it has to be so complicated, but you know, we've got all these different options in here and it talks about things, but it doesn't seem to match up with these batteries. And the main reason is because these guys only have 4 different switches and these have 6. And then on this, it says that that if you're using EG4, the EG4 protocol is supposed to be down, up, 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 up. And that doesn't work over here. Because the last two, and I learned this from Gavin, is that the last two are going to determine the battery. And I don't see that anywhere in this manual. It might be in the revised online manual, so that would be helpful. But the last two are for how you're communicating with the battery, and the first 4 are for the inverter. So you're going to put 1 down if you've got an EG4 or a LuxPower inverter, like the 6000 XP. And then you're gonna put these two down like this if you are communicating with older EG4 batteries. Now the next thing, what do you do with these guys? Because you can't leave these the way that you used to. So you have to go over to, and the manual that ships with it, page 10, and you're gonna look at this. And you're only worried about the first 4. So this is your new battery, and then your first of the old batteries is going to be up, down, up, up. And then the next one is down, down, up, up. So the first battery in the rack of the V1s is going to be up, down, up, up. The next one is down, down, up, up. The next one is up, up, down, up. Down, up, down, up. And up, down, down, up. And down, 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 up. All right, went over that fast, but you can see it right here. It's great to know that EG4 is giving us backwards compatible options, and they're actually working toward making sure that all of the software matches up the way that we need it to. It's gonna take them a little bit of time, I'm sure. Just keep looking for those updates and the firmware updates for both the 6000 XPs or whatever your inverter is, as well as both of the batteries. I'm sure all of that's going to change over time. Now's a great time to pick up a new V2 battery to go with your old V1 rack, or mix and match with any of the other batteries you have. All the documentation seems to be out there now. It's super simple. I probably made it more complicated than it needed to be, but hey, that's how we do whenever we're shooting these videos. Hey, don't forget to use my discount code if you're going to buy one of these or anything else at Signature Solar, because you'll get $50 off. And look for the deals that they do periodically for free shipping and stuff like that. And use my link. That would help me out a lot. I really appreciate it. If you're having issues, leave comments below. I will do my best to try to answer them. And as always, this is Eric with East Texas Homestead, reminding you to live faithfully, prepare thoroughly for good times or for bad. See you on the next one.